Hello and welcome to video 14 of this series. In the last video, we had a look at the telemetry packet definitions, so how the packet looks like so that we can extract them correctly, so the parameter values, for example. And now we will do some examples, complete extraction, and do some small updates. So first thing is what always bothered me was if you write some JSON with ASON into file, because it uses a hash map internally, the fields are in no particular order. And so this can mess up it a little bit visually. So what I found in the ASON pretty package, you can actually specify a key order. And so I tried it out, and it works quite well. So let's show how it works. Basically, also as I tried already this, let's see. So you have a config from ASON pretty. Encode FA. No, not stack build. And FA. That's it. Right, yeah. So basically, you take the default config and set in a compare function. The compare function in this case is this key order function from here, this key order function. And then you can specify a number of keys. And these are the names of the fields from the packet definition and from the parameter definition. So we get them in order. So that's cool. And then we append this with compare, with the standard compare function for the rest. Yeah. So all other fields which are not in this name will then be used in normal compare function. And then what we just have to do is we then use, now that we use this encode pretty and encconfig, and this should basically then sort them. So let's define some of these default defs. Let's actually move them afterwards. So let's define a first packet. Yeah. So let's define an egg packet, which is a TM packet def. Let's just copy the fields. Something like that. Name, let's call it actually let's call it arc one. And we can make this a little bit more flexible when we get in a subtype. So the type of, let's say this is an acknowledge package. Okay, so to explain it. When you send a command to the spacecraft, then you have some verification that the command is there. And there are some stages before. So ground station got the command, ground station radiated the command to the spacecraft. Spacecraft has received it. And then the spacecraft reports with a telemetry packet that it says, okay, I have got this command and I've started execution, and now I've accepted the command, I've started execution, and now I've completed execution. So you get all the steps. And this is always service type one. So this type subtypes, the types define the kind of service, and the subtype defines then the message within the service. So one is for telecommand acknowledges, six is for software uploads and downloads from the satellite, 11 is for managing the onboard queue, 13 is for large data transfers, 9 is for time services, and so on. And you can also define your own ones for your own satellites. So I just want to make it like this. So then we can define for service one, and with also different subtypes, we then get acknowledged packages. And then we have a name, and then we also need an APIT. And the APIT for acknowledge is 17 in our case. One, and then we need a vector. So we haven't imported vector, right? Qualified multiple declaration of default divs. All right, yeah. Too much copy. Not display text, text display. Okay, we don't have a type. Yes, okay, yeah, right. Also forgot this in the last thing. So last time we made also this hex bytes thing, which is then basically a readable, not a readable, a show. We have a show instance, a to JSON, a from JSON instance for these hex bytes that we can transfer them as text. And we also need then a display type for back again, what is display? Display is the class from the logging from Rio. Yeah. So display has basically one of two methods you have to define. One is display, which converts some A into an UTF-8 builder, and text display converts directly to text. So in this case, I use text display, which converts this directly, here, which converts this type directly to text, and then we pack this to this name, so that we get the acknowledge service type, service subtype as a string. And let's also implement display class for pass type. X display X, so this is simple in our case, and also let's do this for the subtype, just the same, and let's also hex bytes, and we do the same as the show instance, we don't unpack it. And let's make it also this, the text display. Right, okay. So now we have this packet definition, so we need some parameters. And actually, there are two parameters which are always present in an acknowledge package. And then there is maybe some other parameters in the failed acknowledge responses. So you have 1.1 is onboard acceptance. Yes, onboard acceptance. 1.2 is then acceptance failure. 1.3 is start of execution. 1.4 is failure of execution. So on the subtypes, the odd ones are success, and the even ones are the failures, and the failures often have then failure information inside them. But let's do first the quick. So, and what they have inside is the first four bytes of the header of the TC, which means the packet ID, a 16-bit, and the sequence control. So let's do parametric packet ID, which is a parameter def. And the parameter def, we need a name. So we need a name, which is in this case is packet ID. The position is right at the start of the packet, of the data part, and the value, this is a UINT16 default value. We specify default value and the type, which is 0. And then the same for the parsedef sec control. control, which is then on in the position 2, so 2 bytes after, is also 16-bit value. And so for these ones, we the param def and the sequence control. And we have our first packet definition. Let's also do this for an example of a failure. I don't know if we will get that right. So packet fail. Fail. This is the same. We have the packet and the sequence control, and then we have a param def fail ID, for example. And let's just copy one of them. And we would have to look it up. So basically, you get this information from the spacecraft manufacturer where what parameters are where in the packet. So the fail ID, and actually I think this is an 8-bit. Let's try this. There are different things, so we would have to define multiple packets, but I think this is an 8-bit word value at offset 6 or something like that. Anyway, let's stay with this, and then for the default definitions, let's define egg packet with parse type 1, one, 3, and 7, and then an fail with 2, 2, 4, and 8. So if you ask where the 5 was left, this is a subtype, sorry. These are subtypes. So if you ask where the 5137, where the 5 is left, the 5 is a progress. So you have multiple of them, and then each one is a step, and we don't care for them currently. So this is the first thing. So basically now let's write them to a file and have a look. So we did this already with the config, so it will be the same. So we add a parameter, a command line parameter, write default emdefs. Right, and then we do the same as here. Write default tmdefs, and then tm definitions. Write them default defs. Into the file default dm definitions JSON. And then we need to import dm definitions. Okay, and then we also want to be able to load them again. Also maybe string specify a tm packet definitions file, right? Tm packet defs. So let's copy this whole block. So, in case nothing is specified, we use the default defs. If we have a file, not read config, but read tm definitions. And we log an error and exit failure if we do, and otherwise we return the thing. Okay. And so we're currently not doing nothing with the devs. So we will then probably have to pass it to the chains afterwards. Yeah. So let's try to write how they look like. So a stack run minus minus write write default tm diffs. Write default tm diffs, I think. Let's see. Wrote default config into tm default definitions.json. Let's have a look. Yeah, so we have the packet apit. Oh, what am I doing? Apit type subtype parameter name position value. Yes, 1.3 packet, 1.7 packet, and so on. So we can now configure the system to whatever we like. Good. So first step done. Next thing, extraction. Yes, this is convert to packet. So basically what we want is first, let's start from bottom up. Extract value. No, extract parameter. So what we want is we get in a parameter definition. So this says how the parameter looks like and where it is in the packet, a byte string. And then we want to get out the parameter value. Do we have to find them? Yes, the text, the validity, and the val. Right, very good. Let's go back. So we get the param def, we get data, and then we want to have a value, a parameter. So first thing is, we can pattern match probably. Parameter def, it has a name, a position, and a default value. And the default value we should match on null. You let's start with the most simplest case. I don't care for the value now. So basically we just index into the byte string if this position is correct. So if pos is within the length, then we reference this. So the value is the data b index. We index the byte string with the position, and then we generate a new parameter. And the parameter has name validity, the param value. The param name we take from the parameter def, which is the name. The validity, in this case, we are is a validity. Okay. And the value is a val int 8 of the new value. And in case we are And in case we are not inside this range, we return a parameter with the name, but the validity is, we are not in the range, so we return an out of bounds, and we return the default value. So let's name this whole construct the default value. Validity out of bound, not in killer. So we need the TM packet. I think we have, I haven't imported it now. Post packet. TM packet. Oh, we have imported it. But we haven't exported probably the validity. Right? Yes. Yes, and then of course we have from integral pos and same here from integral pos and pattern matches are non-exhaustive, right? So the next thing would be the 16-bit value. Name pass, and this is then the 16-bit value, and not the pause, but from integral pause plus one. So we have a, because 16-bit is a 16 is 2 bytes, so the first and the second byte need to be. And then we need to convert that, and maybe we should factor it out. Well, let's first write it. The new val is something. Let's first, we have to get 2 bytes, B0, which is that the index from integral pos, and B1. One. And the new val is then, since we are again big endian, B0 shift, no, from integral, we need to convert it to a word 16, shift left by 8 bits, and then or B1. And this is then a 16. And we need to import 8 bits. Okay. Something went wrong. Ah, this one was it. Okay, yeah. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. So we already see some kind of pattern here. So we have some kind of a function which generates a new value, but this stays the same. We have a position check, and then we have this two parameter generation based on this default value. So actually, we should factor it out somehow. Let's try it something different. So we give it the parameter def. So basically this function is, the goal is to pattern match and then generate this thing. So parameter def, we give it a size. So the size, which is then an int, probably. And we give it the data, the byte string, and return a parameter, a value, and we return a parameter. Get parameter. Parameter def name plus default value. Then we get the size, the data. Okay. So if the from integral pose plus size must be less or equal to b length data. If this is the case, then we generate a parameter with name, validity, okay, and the new value. So we need to pass in somehow maybe we will call this a function which takes in the byte string. Now generates a value, something like that, and call this getVal function, getVal dot, something like that. Let's try it like this, and this is actually quite small. Else parameter name validity out of bounds and the default value, something like that. Okay, text pretty show value. Yeah, we don't need a show value from text pretty show. Where is it? Okay, so then let's try to do this first with this get parameter definition. The size is 1, dot, and the function which is bindex dot from integral plus. Couldn't match type value with actual. And this is of course a value int 8. Blah blah. Yes. Dot. I don't use the name and we need the pattern match. And okay, so let's try the same for this. So get parameter def2, but so this is the definition. And then we need a function get six get well. Let's get word 16. Right, okay. So let's write this function. Get word 16, which should take a byte string and return value. We also need the position. We can even just skip that. Just pass in a value because of the lazy evaluation. Even if we let's call this new value, if you say explicitly this is lazy, then it won't be evaluated, and then we can just do it like this. Yeah, and okay, forget word 16. Where we need the offset. So I've deleted this, okay. That offset let B0 is let B index offset. Offset plus one. And okay, this is a verse 16. And let's say to convert this. B0 shift left by 8-bit or B1. So why don't we use a parser here for simple such accesses which are not in a sequence? It's better to directly, because they could be in any order, the parameters. There could be gaps in between parameters. They could be overlapping even. Yeah. So we don't know. We have to get them explicitly out from there, and then the parser for just getting a single word out of it is a little bit too much. So in while you in 16 new one. So let's make this strict. And here we have then the new one. Okay. Right. Couldn't much expect the type value. We need to get word dot post. Right. And default is not used. Name is not used. And okay, that's good. We have, what values do we have? We have in 16, a float double and an octet. Maybe let's also add a 32-bit value. So basically, then let's do the same for the 32-bit value, and then also probably for the 60-bit. So get word 632. It's the same. So blah blah blah. We then have more. 2, 3, 2, 3, and then we have B0 shift 24, B1 16, not B0, B1, B2, 8. B3. And then we return a value 32. Okay, very good. So we can then simply call this 32-bit, get word 32, and the size is 4. Yeah, works. Good. So the next thing is floating point. Float and double. So how are they stored in the packet? So what is the format? Fortunately, the format is easy. The floats and doubles are stored in the IEEE format. So basically default floating point format that nearly all languages use. We have also some other formats. So MIL standard floating point with 32 and 48-bit. Don't want to go into them here. So they have to do format conversions. The thing is, what you get out here, basically the idea is to read, for a float, you read the 32-bit value out, so word 32, and then do some kind of reinterpret cast in C++ to a float, something like that, or you need to copy that. And you can do that in Haskell, basically. There is a package for this, which is called reinterpretcast. And so let's just have a look at it. I think this is exactly what we need. So reinterpretcast, I think it's called. Yeah. And you have, see, word to float, which converts a word 32 to a float, and a word to double World 64 to double. So if you do low level binary implementation, so how exactly does this work? This may be interesting. So you run a in the ST model, the function, the cast function, so they generate an array of this type with zero, with these values, cast this array into another array. So you have an array of a one element array of a word, and then cast this to a one element array of a float, and then you have basically the values of the word interpreted, the bit values interpreted as a float, and that's it. So this is how this works. Quite simple. If you have done low-level C in C++ code, it should be a little bit familiar at least. So let's again get the float function. So what we don't do here is this check if this position is valid. So this is done in this function already. It should be done in this, the if check. And because this is lazy, this won't get evaluated. This will only get evaluated when we need it. Yeah, so that's a little bit the trick behind this. And then we have to make this value then strict in the packet so that itself the value will then factually been created. So what did we do? We had a dot with the offset string, offset prime. So what we do is basically, actually we should factor that out, not create a value for the word 32, and then return the new one. And in 32, that would be more correct. Yes, so let's also do this for the word 16. Just return new one. Yes, new in 16. And we have mismatched brackets. Yes, of course. So get float, so we return a float. And the thing is, what we have is we want to have a get word 32 dot offset prime, and this word we need to import this ring to breadcast. And then of course import it, data read breadcast. And then word to float, I think it was called. Okay, we have an error here. Get word 16, yes, this should then be a word 16, right? Defined but not used, get float. Okay, that's good. So let's copy that in case we have a val float. Size is 4, well, float, get float. Yeah, that's good. And then we have to do the same for a double. So we haven't had the 64-bit values. Yes, and the same here. While bubble. Get double, and the size is 8. Right. And then we have one left. And this is the octet. Okay. For an octet, we have to do something completely different. Because octet strings are normally stored, they are different. You have fixed size octet strings, and then you have length variable octet strings, and they are stored differently. And we would have to distinguish them on the value. So we would have a val fixed octet and a val octet. And the octet one is, in this case, is the variable one. So it has a normally it has a 16-bit value of the length, and then the octet string itself. So what we need to do is we need to check the position. So we first need to get the length out of it. So we call getWord16 with the dot and the offset. Now we have to check that first. So if pulse from integral pulse plus 1 is less than b length that. So we need to get the length out first. Then let length else we just generate parameter name, and this is then the default value. Right, so error input is, so we have the length, and then we have to get the new data, which is b take, no, because we have to go to the offset, and then from there take. So basically we should, what we actually should do is split at this offset, so we have something we can ignore, and then we have the rest is b split at from integral offset, now length, no, offset, from integral pulse, that's, yeah, we split it at the offset plus 2. So the length, the offset is the pointer to the length information. We remove the length information, so this is pulse plus 2. There we split the byte string, throw away the first part. But, and then new dot is then b take from integral length from the rest. In parameter name validity okay, and val octet new dot. And this is also wrong because we have to check this again. So of course we have to check if the length from integral length pulse plus 2 plus length is less than or equal b length of the data. And if this is the case, then we take this, else we have the same as here. Okay. So why this length calculation, and why we have a less than equal, sometimes we have less than, sometimes we have less than equal. If we are operating with indices, we have a less than. If we have a size, then we have less than equal, then we spare us to write this minus one. So this zero-based index correction. And the thing is, we have now overlocked it, so we have to do this hex bytes. Wrap it into hex bytes. Data constructor not in scope. Didn't we export it over here? Post types, didn't we import it? No. Couldn't match type, okay. The val octet has a hex bytes, right. So what do we have? B length is applied to too many arguments. Where are we talking about B length? Also from integral. Yeah. And we don't have, yeah, not the offset. This is a post, not the offset. Biggest type variable, row, from integral. From integral post plus 2. Length is a word 16, post is a word 16. Why can't it compare it to an int? Foldable. Okay. Okay, let's just quickly and suddenly it's okay. Okay. Something when type inference got wrong. Okay. So we have to extract the parameters. Good. So this is the low level stuff. So basically what we now want is to implement this thing here. So we get the packet index, we get a post packet, we want to have a TM packet. Okay, so let's do this. First thing is we want to look up, so we need a packet key. Let's make it quickly like that. Packet key, yeah. So we get from the push meta packet, we need the, I've forgotten how this is, pp meta packet. Pp meta packet, push packet. So we need the apiet. Let's make this, rename this. Meta packet. Packet header plus. No, it's called push header. Huh? Push header. Yeah. Push packet. And from this push header, we need the header apiet. Then we need the types. Do we have a function for this? Oh, sorry. No, we don't have. Okay. if edge types, I want to have a POSSEC header into a POSS type, POSS subtype. In case of the empty header, return zeros, because these are invalid pass types. We could also return a maybe, but then it gets a little bit more complicated, so I just want to stay with that. And then we have to pass standard header, pass standard header, pass standard, how is it called? Sec standard header. Let's use record wildcards for now. And this is then, how did we call them? DFH type and subtype. And of course we have to, we should have done this before, so record wildcards is also a nice extension. Equations have different number of arguments. Well, actually, we need to set the parentheses here, yes. And then DFH types. That was a length, we didn't export it. So let's get them. Type subtype, DFH types. P plus sec header plus packet, right? And then this is type subtype in. Couldn't match pipe plus packet loop, okay? Second, I couldn't match expected type post packet with. Oh, this is the meta. Yes, okay, good. Then what we do is we do a lookup of the key in the packet index. And then we can get either a packet, a definition, and we do something, or we get nothing, and we do something. So, when we get the packet definition, so this means we have found the packet. Actually, what we just do is, we generate the TM packet. Let's go. Wow. Okay, so the name is easy. We take this from the team definitions. Oh god, how is the name? So let's quickly change here. TMP def name from the packet definition. The apit is the apit of the packet definition. The type we already have as apit. Yes, apit type. Subtype we already have. The source sequence count we have to take from the meta packet, so it's from the header. This is post header, post packet, and the header has the source sequence count is p header source sequence count. The v virtual channel ID. We have to take this from, oh, we don't have it. Because we, from in the meta packet, we should also with the quality, but also let's add the virtual channel ID, which is about it. And we will have to add that also later. So it's gleich P. Oh God, my brain is like a leak. PPVCID. From the meta packet. The timestamp, we don't have it. The ERT is from the PPERT, meta ERT, from the meta packet. Quality also. We should have an equal sign. PP meta quality from the meta packet. And the parameters for now, they are undefined. And the timestamp is maybe UTC time. Oh, we don't have the timestamp yet. So timestamp maybe book time. We don't have one, and in case of this, we return the timestamp, which is the PT fetch time. And in adjust, of course, yes, you're right. And then we also need this for the post packet. And here we want to have a UTC time. So we take the postsec header from the packet, apply this DFH timestamp to it, then we get the maybe cook time and we to UTC time. This is this function we have mapped this. This is this one class we generated, we implemented, which converts the timestamp, this encoded time, cook time, and CDS time to a UTC time. And we have no UTC time because we haven't imported it. Not in scope, yes, we have to include all the time. Import time. And then, yes, this time, where do we have it? Yeah, this time just contains this class with this one function. So just for completeness. So, and then we have to export this. So we have DFH timestamp and post packet timestamp. And then we have here post packet timestamp post packet. HM lookup, not in scope, yes, okay. Rio. Not in scope, pick the if. Wait. Yeah. Code packet def. Oh yeah, there we have the PVCID. We have to set that, and this is the meta. No, this is from the meta, yes, meta frame, and then from the frame header, and from the frame header we have then frame header virtual channel ID. Good. Let's go back to this function. Okay, this is good. So we generate the packet and then we need to extract the parameters. Okay. And now let's do this in a let. So we want to extract the parameter def on a byte string. Ah, okay. So basically we should change this so that we can map over this vector of parameter definitions. This is a little bit boring now. Right, so a possibly incorrect indentation, yes. The thing is, in this packet definition, let's put it in again. We have this vector of parameter definition, so we need to get this from the packet def. Then we have a vector of parameter definitions, and now we loop over this and map over this, over each of them, and call this extract parameter function. So we map extract parameter with the data part of the packet. So this is post data of the post packet. So I hope this is not too confusing. It probably is. And then of course we have to add in vmap, we need to import the vector. Rear vector. And this compiles. Very good. So this extracts the parameters out of this, from these parameter definitions in this data. And then we have a packet. So what do we do in the case we don't have them? Well, then we do something similar. But then we don't have params. So then what we do is we create a simple parameter with the name content, validity, okay, and this is a val octet, and this just has the data inside. So post packet, so in case, let's make this smaller, so in case we don't find the packet definition for this packet, what we do is we take the whole content of the packet as one single byte string parameter. And then, of course, we don't have the packet definition, so that we can't do this here. So the name is then unknown. And the APIT has to be taken from here. Actually, we could factor that out. And then we can also use it here. And then, yeah, okay, yeah, we have a hex bytes. And this is then, this is a parameter. Let's also factor this out. meter. And then here we have singleton. So a vector with a single element of this part. Compiles. Beautiful. So last step. So we have now this convert. So the last thing we need is convert tm packet conduit, which is a conduit t, takes in a post packet meter and generates a tm packet. And then we're done. Hopefully. So what we do, we await forever. We get the meter packet. And what do we do with this packet? Convert to the m packet. And we need a packet index, so we need to pass that in somehow. Meter packet. And we yield this downstream. And then we need a packet index, that's right. Packet index, so we need to pass that in as a parameter. No instance for mo.m, yes. And that's it. So we have now this convertm packet. So let's add this to our chain. We have now the conduit. So here we have our processing chain, extract packets, and then we show them. So now we do it like this, and we have to pass it in the packet index. So we need to generate first, or we need to pass it in packet index. We pass it in, okay? And then of course, we need to pass this packet index in. So we need to also run chains. We need some packet index. And we need to pass it to this chain, yes. And so we need to pass it here and here. So we have loaded devs. So let's generate a packet index. Generate packet index. We wrote the function for this, so it's very easy. Actually, we could also do it like this, hopefully. And then pass the devs in here. Woohoo! This compiles. Very beautiful. Length. Oh, okay. Length shadows. Okay. Biggest type variable again. Why? Oh, this was the problem. Def not used here, that's right. All good. Wow. So let's see what we get. If the system blows up, or if we really get then final packet values. Actually, we should have done some more packet definitions, because the packet definitions... let's see. So let's go to the test data, cat. We had also our signal here. Let's see what we get. Oh! we get TM packets, unknown packets. So this is an idle packet. Unknown packet type, APIT type 325. Timestamp, okay, the timestamp looks suspicious. Earth reception time looks good. Quality good, and we have, of course, we have a content, but we don't know. We don't know this packet yet, so we have no packet definition for this. So let's correct this. At one thing also, we have also the idle packets, so we should throw them away. So we have the chain here. And I will be lazy, because I've already done this. So this is a conduit which just drops the idle packets. So basically this is a filter conduit, which is provided by the conduit library. And if we get from this meta packet, which we get out, we select the APIT, and if this APIT is the idle APIT, which is defined here in the post packet somewhere, yeah, here, if this is the idle APIT, then we just throw it away, otherwise we yield it. So then we should not get the idle packets. So we drop the idle packet, we do this after the packet extraction. So let's do that. Right here. And yeah, okay. All good, very good. And the second thing is, let's add a definition for this other packet. So we have here a packet for the acknowledges. So this is a HKTM. And it doesn't take a subtype. So this is... So the APIT is 20, 23, 25, 3, 5, and then we add two parameter definitions. Let's quickly write them. STKTP51. I know this packet by heart. So the parameter name is then STKTP51 S2K. So the version is, I have to look it up. I don't know it by heart, but this is a on offset 30. We will have a look afterwards at the precise thing so that you can get a little bit of a more understanding. And this is a floating point. So 4 bytes, and then we have the same with the 542, which is then on 34, if I'm correct. Yes, 34. And this is a double. And for this packet, then we have this packet has a lot of other parameters, and I will show them afterwards. But yes, and then we add this to the list of default things. Right. So let's run this again, and now we should get, if we've everything done correctly, we should get values for the first time in history. Wow, and we get values. And see, these values look good. We have floating point values, we have double values. This packet is correctly identified. HKTM has the APIT 20. 325 is the housekeeping telemetry of the satellite. So this is data from the satellite itself. This is a source sequence count, 5,000, 4,999, 4,998. So sequence count looks good. The time is bogus. ERT quality is good. And we have validity okay, and we have the correct values. At least it seems so. So let's just quickly fix this error with the time. So the conversion, no, here we are. So this time is always zero, but we have a large number of subseconds, which is very, very bogus. So the day looks okay, but this time is completely wrong. So there's something wrong going on. Let's have a look at the cook time. Where is it? Yep. And, okay, yeah. Know already what the problem is. So, days in sec. So we have then to, these are the microseconds, the picoseconds are the days in sec times, so milli, micro, nano, pico, and basically from integral plus the microseconds. Okay, let's run it again. Oh yeah, now we're talking. Right. The thing is, what we don't do here is leap seconds correction, and the simulator which generated this data does leap seconds correction. So that's a little bit unfortunate, but yeah. So we are now quickly right over time, but I just want to quickly show you something. So I'll just pause the video, do the setup, and then I'll show you something. Okay, back, just a little brief update. So let me show you this. This is a real spacecraft simulator, also written in Haskell. I have to restart it because I've blocked the port before. Right, so this is a real simulator which is used for testing actual mission control systems. It is used at the German Space Operations Center, and it's also used for the European Space Agency in the current project I'm working on. We do performance tests with this thing. And this can generate satellite telemetry. It's one of the things. So it has a lot of things to do. And it's basically, you know, now how this thing works. We'll go into the user, how to create such a user interface in the next episodes. So I will just load up the data of the satellite. This is a test MIP. This is not a real satellite. And now what we do is we run our program, which we have written, and it says starting app, and it has connected. We see here connection indicator, connection is green, telemetry is there. And then let's try, for example, a simple thing. So we have this, this is a TC acceptance success, so this is a telecommand acknowledges. This has AP17 type 1, subtype 1. So we. This is actually something we have a packet definition for in our system. So if we now send a packet, we should get something. And we get something. We get the ARC11, subtype 1, and the value 00. So let's add the value, for example, 10, and of course 42, because 42 is always a good number. And we get 10 and 42. So this is really cool. Really cool. Let's try another packet, this one packet with the floating point numbers. This is a housekeeping diagnostics packet, and this packet. Yeah. And you see you have a lot of parameters, 4-bit, 5-bit, 6-bit, 7-bit, 8-bit, 32-bit parameters, and then we have two floating point numbers, and these ones are the ones that are interesting. So send it now, and we get 0-0, as we expected, and now let's enter 1.5, and 3.14. Let's click send, and we get 1.5 and 3.14. Yeah, success. Okay, so we can now parse telemetry and view it, at least in the terminal. So the next episodes will be about putting this into a graphical user interface so that we can view them online. And maybe also do some speed tests to see how Conduit performs, or how the system generally can parse this data with what speed. So that's it for now. Maybe afterwards, at the end of the series, we will have a look at this Paragon CT again, and also on Auris itself. So this worked finally. So this is a big milestone. We have parameter values. We can parse packets. We get finally the data out of them. So let's conclude here. This video is far too long already. And we will have hopefully then shorter videos for the graphical user interface. Thanks a lot. Thanks for watching.